Good morning. It's good to see all of you this morning. Welcome to Rocky Mount. We're so happy that you are here to worship with us this morning. And so happy if you are joining us for the first time. We hope that you feel welcome. This is a church that tries to be more about relationships with Jesus first and foremost, and then relationships with others. That's our goal around here. We try to do that. And one way to do that is to meet people and to know people. So if you would, why don't you stand up, stretch your legs, pass God's peace.
Doesn't stand a chance when I'm standing your love.
praising God for the victory that we have in Jesus. Would you pray with me? Oh, gracious God, we are so incredibly grateful for the fact that you sent your Son to die for us, that we can have our sins covered by his blood, by his precious blood, Lord. We are so grateful for that. Your grace is beyond measure, God, and we never take that for granted. Lord, as we continue to worship you here this morning, I pray that your Holy Spirit would just minister to us in mighty, mighty ways. God, I pray that this anointed message that you've given to Jamie, Lord, will be able to be heard. It is a message that so many of us fall victim to. And so, God, just use your word to fill us with your grace. And, Lord, I just ask these things now. I ask them in the name of Jesus that taught us these words to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. You may be seated. This past Wednesday, we met, we had a meeting downstairs, and a lot of the leaders of the church were there. How many of you were part of that meeting and that gathering, that summit, that leadership summit on Wednesday? If you were, raise your hand. Yeah. Yeah, there were probably 100 folks there that came out on a Wednesday night, and you know, we Methodists, we don't do Wednesday nights, and so there we were worshiping on a Wednesday night, totally out of character for us, but we managed. And it was great. It was a wonderful evening just to kind of set the vision for 2020. And so before we got too far into 2020, I thought I would share some wonderful statistics that came out of 2019 from you, this church, Rocky Mount. So our average attendance during 2019 was 971 folks that on an average came in and out of this facility on Sunday mornings to worship God and to praise his name, and I think that's awesome. And here's another statistic that is just blows my mind every time I read it. You gave to our general fund $1.8 million last year, which is phenomenal. That's not special giving, that's just to the general fund, which is amazing. We still owe on our building, so our loan balance is still $3,724,000. But we're knocking that down because of our giving. Maybe I should change this around. But here's the thing that just, there are so few churches that get to say this. I just can't tell you. 16 years in a row, this church has ended the fiscal year in the black. And we didn't just squeak by. We ended with $16,000, and so we were strong even in the end. And so that is fantastic. It's not about us. It's not about any of us. It's all about God and just his good and gracious self. And it's about you for being cheerful givers. And we appreciate you so much. Thank you. If the ushers would please come forward.
To calm the storm. Our teams are raring to go, so come and support them for a night of fun and fellowship. Starts at 6:30. We are so glad you joined us this week at Rocky Mount. Have a great day.
Good morning, church. Glad to see everybody here today. And, you know, I know G put it out this morning, but we don't want to be churchy. That's the last thing we want at this church, is to be religious. It's about a relationship with Jesus Christ, first and foremost. And in relationships with each other. So we're in this series called Chasing Carrots. For some reason, humanity thinks it has to go after everything. And most of the stuff that we go after is a lie. It's unreachable in the first place. We want stuff, we want power, we want popularity. Today we're gonna look at one that's probably gets me more than anything, and that's approval. I want approval. I don't know about you, but I want people to like me. Will you please like me today? Will you accept me? Will you please lie to me and say good message when you walk out? I would greatly appreciate it, because that's what I live for a lot of times. And that's scary. If you're being totally honest, with a raise of your hand, how many of you think you might care too much about what other people think? Thank you. We have a lot of people that have issues with the truth at our first service. If you're raising your hand, it does make me feel better, because I think I may have a problem with it, and I am in the wrong business to want everybody to like me and for that to be an issue. A lady by the name of Harriet Breaker wrote in her book on approval, says, approval is the disease to please. She compares it to a form of addiction where drug addicts crave drugs. Humans with approval issues, we just want to please. We want everybody else to be happy. And there's some problems that go along with that. But first, before we get into that, let's see what Scripture says, because you wouldn't think it if you just off the top of the head, but it's everywhere in Scripture, this one topic. Now, you know, it might be written in different ways or said in different tones or whatever, but it's all the same thing. It all goes back to the first commandment. You can't have anything in front of me. So our scripture this morning, Proverbs 29:25 and Galatians 1:10. If you can and if you will you please stand for the reading of God's word? Now, fear of man, Solomon says, fear of man will prove to be a snare. But whoever trusts in the Lord is kept safe. And then the words of Paul in Galatians, am I now trying to win the approval of human beings or of God? Or am I trying to please people? If I were still trying to please people, I would not be a servant of Christ. Let's pray. God of grace and mercy, help us today to care about what you think more first and foremost. Help us to live out of your approval instead of always trying to go and get others' approval. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Now, for those of you that are people pleasers, it's always you care too much about what people think. I mean, do you like my outfit? No, I'm asking, do you like my outfit? You know, I realized something. We had this little discussion last night at my house. You're not going to believe this, but I actually dressed myself for 25 years. I don't know how I did it. I'm surprised I wasn't getting arrested for being naked somewhere. But I dressed myself for 25 years. And for the last 26 years, I have not dressed myself. And if I have, I've been told that I dressed wrongly. Just last night, I was getting out my clothes to come today, and I had a red and blue checkered shirt. And I had a red vest to wear over it. And I had black dress pants. And I pulled that out, and I heard that graceful remark. Are you gonna wear that? No, I just thought I'd put it out here just to stare at. Yes, I'm wearing. Honey, that don't match. It does. This is red, and this is red, and this is black. It does. Well, I found out something last night. I'm 48 years old. I found out something that evidently colors have families. Did you know that? That it's not in the same, that color is the color, but that red is not in the same family of that red. Well, where's the tree? Because I don't see where the genealogy goes on, you know? And then she said, I said, well, I'm going to wear this color with this color. And she said, no, that doesn't match either. And she said, you can only wear that vest if you find something that really works with the same color. And I said, well, do I have anything that same color? No. I said, so you bought me that vest, but I don't have anything I can wear it with. Well, I'm looking. That's the world that I live in. So in the end, I pulled out this shirt, and I pulled out this vest, and I pulled out these pants. Are you going to wear denim as the preacher of the church? Yeah. I just don't think you should be wearing denim. You're talking to 1,000 people tomorrow. You need to be in dress pants. That's just how I grew up. So I really need your approval today. Please, give me some love, all right? But I obsess about what other people think, and I am in the wrong business. Is my hair okay? Am I cool enough? Am I hip enough? Why in the world are you not responding to my text as quickly? Because I saw the bubbles, but then they disappeared, right? Or I am never more vulnerable than I will be in 2 hours. 2 hours, I will leave here and I will walk into the kitchen of my house. And every single day when I come home, my dog, Tank, runs up to me, jumps on me, playing, loving. All he wants to do is kiss me and be patted on the head. On Sundays, that's what I am going home to Michelle. Oh, was my sermon good? Please tell me my sermon was good. Please pat me on the head. Please tell me it was good. And it's pitiful. It's pitiful to want someone's approval. I got wife-ish. Mercy me. We care about what other people think. And here's another thing. If you're a people pleaser, you're probably very sensitive when it comes to criticism. You could have 100 people tell you something is good, but that one person, that's what you're going to carry with you all day long. Not those 100, it's that one. Can I get an amen from you people that are if that's what you live off of, you feed off that negativity and it just drives you crazy, and it does that to me. And then the last thing I think majorly that people pleasers have a problem with is we have made the word no a bad word. It's the only two-letter bad word. We just can't say, you want to avoid conflict at all costs. You want to avoid conflict. You don't want to hurt somebody's feelings. Now, I don't want to hurt your feelings today, but do you know how many $28 boxes of popcorn I've bought? Do you know that I don't even know how to wrap a Christmas present? But by golly, I've got the rolls of paper to prove it, that I don't know how to wrap. Did you know that I have got more subscriptions to different magazines and I don't even read? Because I can't say the word no. No. And it's something that's I've really got to grow with. I've really got to grow in that. You know, we're facing a little bit of a tough time here at church with staff. We are very, very thin right now. And it's usually one pastor for every 200 people. Well, last week we had 1,300 and there's two pastors. We're thin. We can't get it done. We've already had a couple people be ugly because we had to say the word no and they didn't understand. You know, you always talk to people and they say, when you tell them someone's angry with you, and they say, well, you can't make everybody happy, right? They say that until you don't make them happy. And then you're demanded to make them happy. So our staff is finding out that you can't make everybody happy. It's okay to say the word no. Our scripture from Proverbs says, the fear of man will prove to be a snare. Now, I'm not talking about fear as in physically hurt you or verbally abuse you. The fear of man more than God is what the snare is. And in that scripture, that Hebrew, that word for snare, it actually means a noose, or it means a hook in the mouth or nose, a snare. So you get pulled along by man, or you get hung up and trapped by man. We can get in trouble really quick, but the scripture also goes on, thank goodness, it says, but whoever trusts in the Lord is kept safe. That's the good news. And here's the cool thing is, God lets you choose. Are you going to get pulled along with a hook in your nose by humanity, or are you going to let God keep you safe? Why does the world tell us to put that noose around your neck, to put that hook in your nose? Why in the world do we do that? Why do we chase approval? You know, it started for me at an early age. I grew up in, I think, is one of the greatest decades in American history. I grew up in the 80s, and it was so cool. I mean, we were just coming out of Love Boat, right? And everybody knew these words, the plane, right? Some of you guys are like, I have no idea what you're talking about right now. I can say these words, these three words, and half of you are going to be like, oh, gosh, that's memories. Where's the beef? Some of y'all are like, who is this dude? And what's he talking about? I grew up in a place where Def Leppard came about. Van Halen came in. Oh, my favorite, and I know this is going to show my age and my lack of music talent, but Hall & Oates. Oh, man, she's a man eater. I just love her. But the biggest one, I guess, for me is the change things. You had Madonna changing things, but the one that really changed, Prince. Oh, Prince. I was such a Prince fan. I'm going to give you some trivia right now. Of all of our staff members, all the people that you know that work at this church, which one of our staff members would you think has seen Prince in concert? Not one time, not two, not three, But four times. Wow. Wow. Okay. If I could have that staff member raise their hand, if you will, turn around and look behind you. Pastor G. See, you thought she was just all this little fireball full of grace, and no, it's coffee and purple rain is what she's got covered all over her. And you always wondered why, how she dresses so neat and has the scarves all the time. Well, she learned it at a Prince concert. She learned how to wear those blouses and those colors and all that kind of stuff. So that's our G. She went from when doves cry to let us stand and say the Lord's Prayer, right? But I remember those days because it was about times changing because we got out of Fantasy Island and we started getting in some really awesome stuff. Like there was this man that had this really awesome mustache and he drove a Ferrari that he didn't even own. And he had these guys, these friends, Rick and TC, and one of them even had a helicopter and they lived in Hawaii. It was so awesome. And there was these other two guys. They changed my world in a lot of different ways. They decided, they lived in Miami. They decided they wanted to take on the whole Cuban drug market all by themselves. And they could do it in these cool clothes. Now, I was very influenced by that. In eighth grade, I had a rat tail. If you don't know what a rat tail is, kids, ask your mom and dad, okay? And then when Crockett and Tubbs came along on Miami Vice, I started wearing these shoes with no socks. And I got my hair permed. And I started wearing these members-only jackets, and I started wearing these really thin ties that were made out of leather. And I had these pants that didn't just zip here, they zipped all the way down, you know? And I started doing something. I would get on my back and spin all the way around two or three times, right? I was break dancing. Now I just break if I dance. I was more worried about what people thought about me and how I looked and if I was cool, even though I was a Christian at the time. And it was all good intentions, but was it really what God wanted for my life? I can be easily concerned with what people think about me. Folks, when you become obsessed with what other people think about you, you quickly forget what God thinks about you. And that's where we get into trouble. That's where you and I have to have a different goal. We can't live for the approval of other people because you can't do it. You can't do it. Do you know that if you make this group happy, you're going to do what? Make this group unhappy. You can't make everybody happy. You just can't. So how in the world do we get to this place where that's what we're striving for in life? How did God get out of the equation? Why aren't we just wanting to live for God and God alone? Paul said this. He said, obviously, I am not trying to win the approval of people, but of God. If people pleasing were my goal, and this is where it steps on my toes and it gets serious. If people pleasing were my goal, I would not be Christ's servant. What pleasing you every week is not my goal. If that's my goal every week, then am I being Christ's servant? If I'm not telling you the truth in what Scripture says, or I'm not calling you on the carpet, or I'm not stepping on your toes, am I being someone that idolizes you? Or am I being someone that worships God? And that's where it gets heavy. That's where it gets eternal. And I think that's where you and I need to get real. because we are talking about a living God that we need to live for and not just say it. We need to do it. There's facts about the disease to please. The first one is this. If you're more worried about what people think, then you are in idolatry. You're in idolatry. You see, this is more of a spiritual problem than it is a relational problem. Jesus said it himself. You see, these people that have been following Jesus, they saw him take his own spit and make it into mud and make a blind person see. They saw people just touch his clothes and be healed. They saw him raise Lazarus from the dead. But they still wouldn't follow Jesus all the way and become a believer for this reason. Look at what it says. But because of the Pharisees, and who are the Pharisees? Men. Because of the fear of men and people, they would not openly acknowledge their faith for fear they would be put out of the synagogue. They were more worried about their status, more worried about their social setting, more worried about their income, more worried about what people said than they were the one that had the power to resurrect people from the actual dead. And we think, how horrible can you be to do that? I've done it a lot. God's jealous. God's got a right to be jealous. Rule number one, don't put anything else above me. I do that a lot. I put my feelings, I put my hopes, I put my goals, I put my desires, I put things I want to do ahead of God. And that's scary. But people pleasing is a form of idolatry. And we need to repent of that. God deserves more than we're giving him. And the approval of God is something that is the one thing that can set us free from the disease to please. Paul says it in 2 Thessalonians, or 1 Thessalonians chapter 2. On the contrary, we speak as those approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel. We're not trying to please people, but God, who tests our hearts. We're not looking for praise from people, not from you or anyone else. How freeing would that be if that's what I started to become more and more each day? Somebody that did not care what the world thinks, but only cares what God thinks. Do you realize how freeing that is? That you don't have to worry about the world anymore? How awesome it would be that you don't have to care about those looks that your mother-in-law gives you? Or how freeing it would be not to worry about what they think about the car you drive, or the clothes that you wear, or what family they're in? How awesome would it be if we could just be free? You cannot please everyone, but I promise you today, you can please God. You are living out of God's approval. You know, the world tells me I'm a lot of things. I've even gone on our Google reviews and seen some things that I am. Seen some things that Gary is. Gary's got a couple nice ones on Google review. He's laughing because he knows I'm not lying. He's really a jerk in our community. But Gary doesn't have to worry about what they think. I don't have to worry, but sometimes I do. And I'm a work in progress. And I hope you know you are too. He loves you. He's even willing to send his son to die for you. So stop letting the world tell you who you are and listen to what God says you are. He says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, you are a new creation in Christ. He says in Ephesians 1, you are forgiven and your sins are washed away. He says in Romans chapter 8, you are a conqueror through Jesus Christ. He says in Ephesians, you are God's masterpiece. He says in Matthew, you, my friends, are the light of the world. And in Romans 8, he says, you have the very same spirit that filled Jesus Christ in the time of resurrection. He says in Romans 8, you are a Christ ambassador, and you are a joint heir with Christ our King. As joint heir, as in you will be with God. You will have his approval. It says in 2 Corinthians 5, you are the righteousness of God in Christ. And in Romans 1, it says, you are greatly loved by God. That's who you are, my friends. Take that to the bank. He loves you. He loves you. All right? Let's pray. God Almighty, I thank you for this time together. And I got to admit, I got to grow in this. I got to get thicker skin. I got to grow some duck feathers, let some stuff roll off my back. But I would say that there's some other people in this very room that need that as well. God, help us to grow in ourselves and more importantly, grow in you. Help us to realize just how much you care. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's stand and let's worship. The altar is open. Please be seated, and I want to ask Richard and Cammie Harris to come up, and their little one is Emma Rose Grace, right? I got that right. All right. I love days like this. I don't know about you, but can you feel the spirit in the room today? I love these days. You can just feel God's spirit and just the energy and everything. Come on over here. We're going to get her wet over here. Yeah. We're going to put... put the little one in front and center. So this is Richard and Cammy Harris. And what's the little man's name?
What's your name?
And Miles.
Miles?
Miles. And he's very outspoken, is he not? I love that. I love that. They are going to join the church today, right?
Yes, sir.
Do you profess Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior? Do you make a profession today that you're going to love your church by praying for it, by witnessing about God, evangelizing and asking others to come to church, by serving, by praying, by being present whenever possible? If you will, say we will. Will you, the church today, welcome the Harris family? Will you welcome them in grace and renewing your vows of presence, prayers, gifts, witness, and service? If you will, say, we will.
Yeah.
We will. All right. Are you ready? Have you had a nap?
She's had a nap and been fed.
Nap and fed. So it might be time for poopy, isn't it? Right. Hey, beautiful. Now, see, your daddy and mommy, especially I think your daddy, understands what colors families look like. You see the blue with the blue, and then he put in the red. See? All right. This is an important day for you and for me and for your parents. You see, they love you so much. They want God to claim you as your own. I know. I know. Oh, mercy. Oh. Oh, my goodness. I'm so sorry. Don't you break my streak. God loves you, and God cares for you, and you are going to get grace whether you like it or not. Amen? Hey, it's a big day for God, because he is claiming you, baby girl. And your mommy and daddy love you so, so much. All right? Oh, mercy. I've got her mad. Are you mad? Oh, now you... You didn't like it because I made fun of your day's bow tie. Emma Rose Grace Harris, it is an honor and a privilege for me today to baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. May God bless you. May God keep you. And may you always know how much you were loved. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh, gosh, Hey, I was just playing, I'm sorry. I thought you might like it. I don't have the Harris family approval now. I'm sorry, I thought you might like it because it was God's water. Is that okay? Anyway, let me pray for you guys, all right? Lord God, please forgive me. I thank you for this special moment in their life and in their kids' life. God, I ask that you watch over them and give them protection. Thank you, Jesus, for loving us and claiming us. It's in your name we pray. Amen. If I could have the Harris family to come down front.